G'day there. So I spent the first 2 weeks of April 2020, COVID-19, school holidays with Grandma. And I pulled her apart, I gave her a great clean, I scrubbed over, I worked out entirely how she works inside, at least I think. But I made a lot of mistakes because I was, pretty wrecked. But I thought I'd take you along for the ride. You can learn a lot from this, and if you've got any questions, please plug them into the comments below and we'll see where we go. Cheers. So after removing 6 screws from around the edge here, let's lift up the skirt and have a look. Yeah, and as you can see, it's pretty filthy. Let's have a bit of a closer look. But, this hasn't been opened in about a decade, so... well, except I did open it earlier, but... lots of crud. Lots of dust. Pretty clean up there, but I'm gonna give it a quick suck and then a quick blow, and then we'll have a bit of a closer look at what's in here, right? Quick measurement of the UPS battery, and 12.5 volts. From what I understand, we're giving it 13.9, but at installation, we were looking at 12.7, maybe that was what this is. Anyway, I think it's fine. I'm gonna run it later and see how long I get on the UPS, but we'll give it a crack. Might be a little tricky to see. I don't know if this is corrosion or just malforming in when the case was, I don't know. I think it might be, it's possibly, some sort of internal corrosion, but I think it would have stopped because the whole surface is painted. You can't get any more air, whatever is going on there, but not quite right. But I can see that somebody has signed off here with a Sharpie. I don't know what that means, but I assume it's quality control and they've approved it. And yeah, look, I would approve of that too. You know, it probably was nothing a while ago. 10 years on, maybe it's something, but I don't think it's going anywhere because there's no there's no oxygen getting in there. How's it gonna get any worse than that? So we will overlook that, I think. So this board is a video breakout board. You can see coming in here, there's DVI connectors. These are actually HDMI to DVI because DVI is basically HDMI. This being the smaller multi-touch screen, these being the two internal screens. Up on the front for the light version. You can see at the end there's an unpopulated section for if this was a full size. If you were to modify this to be a full size, you would just duplicate the circuitry, so you would get these chips and solder on them there. So this chip is an SIL1161 panel link receiver. So what it's doing is taking in DVI and decoding it kind of into like FDP flat panel display format, and that's going straight across to this little chip here, which is in the shadows. It's a DS90C365 LDVS transceiver. So LDVS is a differential signaling system for LCD panels. So I suppose it's LCD video differential signaling. I don't know what LDVS stands for, but basically there's differential pairs heading up to the different displays. So something to note on this board is not only is it May 2006, so this is the earliest board I can find in this console dating it to 2006. Further, I see this here as a small 1K EEPROM, serial EEPROM. So note it's got two dots on it, so I think that's a special identifier that it is for the smaller multi-touch display. So I'm figuring this is EDID or something. Probably EDID. There is actually a firmware file, I think, that's specific to this that we might pull up later. But you can see these other two units. Well, you might not see that one, but they've got one white dot. These are 1280 by 800 panels, and this is a 800 by 400. So this is the smaller display. These are the two other displays. And here was the gas strut that I was talking about earlier, which is manufactured by a company called Bernsterbach. Let's have a crack at what's here. We've got PSU plus and ground coming from the 13.9 volt mains to DC power supply. And then we got positive and negative off to the UPS battery. This connector here is also sending some signaling off to the 13.9 volt power supply. I don't really know what. Probably like power good and checking rails and whatever. Maybe some feedback, I don't know. These are power MOSFETs, NTP125s. And there's also one over here that's not heat sunk as well. So I'm going to presume that these have to do with battery charging, and this is probably just a general regulator. Not a regulator, but just a general sort of distribution switch. We've got a big cap there. These modules over here are LSN2T161D12Cs. These are going to be pre-built modules that this, you can see this is a multi-layer board as well. They're going to be tiny little switch mode power supplies providing some sort of rail, probably 3.3. This module here, I'll put a photo of the back in it as well, but I think that this is going to be a big ass 3.3 volt regulator with a nice heat sink on it to keep it cool. If you didn't think Grandma 2 had three-phase motor control, well, you were wrong. Over here there is an L6234, and this is a three-phase motor controller, and what this is going to be doing, I believe, is driving the stepper motor that's running the display up and down as well. We got CAN bus connection here, which is going to be, this is going to be power out to the CAN bus for sure. But given this cable's so big and CAN bus is really only sort of two signals in ground, there's other control signals in here, and what is going to be going on is this is going to be controlling power to the little lights as well, and potentially telling the signaling to the system that the AC power is lost and that we're running on battery. Yeah. So, and that's going off to, actually, I haven't traced it out, but I'm going to presume it's backlight. It's going to be power for the LCD backlights. And it looks like we've got 1, 2, 3 groups. So, yeah, that's going to be backlight power as well. What's that say? That's 5 volts and ground out to something. Over here, this board is, this connector looks like an ATX connector, but it's not. It's a custom MA2 arrangement. This is little lights and power to all other boards in the system. So there's 12 volts going to there, there's 5 volts going off to the back, there's 3.3 volts going off somewhere else. But what this is a full ATX, which is going to be 3 volts. 3.3 volts, 5 volts, 12 volts, neg 12 volts somehow, and other stuff off to the motherboard up that away. Which, you know, is essentially this links directly pin for pin to the motherboard, so that's your normal computer power. This board 2008, so not the oldest board in the rig. These will be polyfuses, PTCs, temperature coefficient fuses. So if they get too hot, they'll self-reset themselves. They'll trip and then they'll self-reset themselves. So what else we got? There's some 7.4 logic here, a 7.4 HCT 104, a 7.4 HCT 106. So some signaling, yeah, as I mentioned, from the bus. There will be little lights, it'll be power good, it'll be UPS kicked in or not, sort of signaling to the software to tell it what the state of the system is as well. There's a couple of LEDs over here off camera, you can't probably see, but they're just indicating that those voltage rails are present. And we got, what do we got, 5 volts, 3.3 volts, and 12 volts. So there might not be a negative voltage. The negative voltage was needed for PC motherboards back in the day for 5 1/4 inch floppy drives, I think, but I don't know that it's even really nearly required anymore. So, but yeah, basically this is taking power from the power supply and sending it out to everybody else. The CAN bus, this is CAN bus, but I don't think CAN bus is being received on this board. I think that we're getting an instruction from somewhere else to dim the little lights up and down, and I haven't quite worked out how that's working yet, but it may be related to the motor driver here as well. But definitely the little lights are going out here. There's two pairs, so for a full size, given this board is for a full size and a light, they're all loops. So one pair goes off that way for that little light, and mine goes off that way for that little light. Otherwise, that's supplying power to the top motor fader board, to the top command board, which has got lots of LEDs on it. Sending 3.3 volts to the display breakout board, which is over that way. And we'll be sending 12 volts and 5 volts to the boards at the back as well that are doing the DMX output and something else, probably not much. And it's driving the stepper motor as well for the display. Of note, install like this with a screw in there is a USB 2.2. What we got here is the command wing side of the board, basically, minus the multi-touch screen and the trackball. But across here we have all the Cherry MX keys mounted on the other side of this board that are all the buttons on the front panel. Attached over that is this control board here, which is driving all of this. Up here is the QWERTY keyboard. Of note, on the QWERTY keyboard, F1 through F10 is actually implemented through this board here and directed up to the keyboard through there, as well as the LEDs that backlight the keyboard. And there are a couple of LEDs on the keyboard that are used but not used in the software that can be controlled as well. Yeah, so further over here we've got the trackball. I've got some further information on the trackball I can give you later. Also with the dimmer wheel as well, I'm not going to bother taking this wheel off because it's all really clean behind there. There's nothing to actually clean. The main board here of interest is the Atmel AT91 SAM7A3. It's a 7 processor, ARM 7 microcontroller. This is well overkill, really, for what we, well, maybe not overkill, but totally sufficient for what we need to do with these. There's 2 per board over on the other board that we'll have a look at later. There's also 2 as well. So these 2 chips are dividing the whole job of looking after this entire section here, which is, you know, it's a bit to look after as well. So coming into this board, that's the trackball connector there as well. And this is connecting to the Grandmaster Motivator. Oh no, sorry, that's the Grandmaster Motivator there. This is the dimmer wheel. This is the trackball. My apologies. I got those mixed up. Along with that as well, we have encoders here. So all the encoders across the, well, we've got a screen encoder and the 4 control encoders, and somehow those are being divvied up. It looks like it goes, in this case, this chip looks like it's looking after these 5 encoders, probably a bunch of buttons, and this is the CAN bus coming in here, so it looks like it's going straight up into there. These chips are pretty cool because they got like 32K ROM, sorry. They are 32-bit in terms that they work with 32-bit instructions as well. They have CAN controllers and everything going for, well, actually, that's the CAN bus transceiver there, and that's another CAN bus transceiver right there. So that's going to be associated with this chip, I'm assuming, and same with here, but they're all on the CAN bus, which is going to be shared through here. It's, what else? Regulator there to supply power to the whole board. Some unpopulated headies here for +5, +12 and ground. That's probably if additional power is required, but it's actually, it's coming in through the CAN bus. Is at least what I'm thinking. What else is going to be happening here is on this board is the MA button. So the MA button is responsible for making the screens go up and down as well. So there'll be messages sent from, well, probably from here through the CAN bus to the motor driver on the PSU board, which is down that way, to tell it to lift the screen up and down. So that's pretty cool. What are they again? They're TLC 594 LED drivers. 5941 LED drivers. So 16 channel LED drivers. There's a stack of them because each button, it has an LED that's individually controllable. So also all of those buttons are all getting read back into the, and they're going to be multiplex across IO from this board onto this board through this flat flex. What else have we got? Oh, I see all these encoders down here are being read. This guy's dealing with reading all the encoders, looking at the traces. This guy's looking after all the keys up here and the trackball as well. Just pan around this way a little bit. Oh, it's all out of focus and shit. Our A and B faders as well are driven off this board. So there's going to be somewhere on here motor controllers to drive these motors. And also ADAC to read these faders. You can see this board jumps over to here. So I'm going to predict that it runs off this side of the board. This here is going to be a backlight. If you can see that there, but that's a backlight driver. It's sort of double-sided taped up there, I think. Yeah, you can see that one's also starting to come away. Backlight driver, high voltage section that's protected with plastic there as well, and it's input through there and control. So this being an MA2 light, it's only got
15 faders on this section of the board. So this would be what you would find inside a expansion wing as well. Got one screen encoder for the screen that's associated with that wing. Faders 1 through 15. And they're all touch sensitive motor faders. Beautiful faders. Up here is, if you slide out the compartment, you find USB sockets up there. So this USB runs straight back down to the motherboard. Up here we've got this big grey cable, which is pretty familiar. We've got your CAN bus, so let's pop that out so we can see what's going on. Just tuck that bit back there for you. Again, we've got two Atmel 91 SAM 7A3s, which are the 32-bit microcontroller brains of the operation for this section of this section. So they're effectively going to be doing 8 faders each, minus 1, because obviously there's only 15 faders. I figure they do that because we have 5 fingers. So in banks of 5, so there's an additional possible channel there that doesn't exist. Each of these connectors, MF1 through MF15, are driving motor faders. That's going to have a motor controller associated with it, as well as a touch sensor, because each fader is touch sensitive and they're obviously under the display. Further up here, we've got more, what are they? TCL5941 LED drivers. So these are 16 channel LED drivers. They're going to be driving all of the LEDs that are on this display, for the X buttons, the buttons up here as well as, the red and the green LEDs under these X keys. I can't remember what do we call those, and that's being commanded across these flat flex cables here. So we're going to be doing a bank of 8 and another bank of 7, because there's only 15. Looks like that this micro is in charge of the encoder. This micro hasn't got an encoder to look after. Both got JTAG connectors, which is great if you wanted to be doing any kind of debugging or try and suck the firmware out of it. What else have we got there? That's what is this? This module here, let's go back here. So this is CAN bus coming in. This is a polyfuse. Power from the power supply, 12 volts and ground. So that's going to be the main input into here, and that's going to be controlled down to the voltage that's required to drive the motors back and forward. Some more sort of power supply here. There's a TGA 1050, so that's the CAN bus transceiver for this board. Oh, there's another one over here, of course, because there's going to be one for each chip, and these chips have got a built-in CAN controller. Well, they've got a two-channel built-in CAN controller, so that's cool. They talk straight to the CAN bus. They don't need the SJA1000 chip added on there either. The 7404, that's a hex inverter, so that's just going to be doing 6 channels of input inversion. This one up here, I looked up earlier, it's a QT1080, so that's an 8 channel capacitive touch sensor, so that's going to be associated with these capacitors here, and that's going to be reading when you touch a fader. These are 2 channel brushless motor drivers. That bang, 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 bang. So each one of those chips is doing 2 of the motor faders, movement control. And clearly they're going to get their power from this regulator up here, which is pushing through a diode, and off we go. Another really nice touch with these boards is these connectors here. your flat flex connectors, typically you fold something up to latch the flat flex into the connector. But these, you push. Yeah, the first thing I'm going to do is jam my fingers into anything I can. And if I'm pushing, I'm giving positive engagement on the contacts rather than pushing and possibly popping out or damaging whatever connector is there. So that's really cool. Interesting to note, I've just connected AC power back and I cannot see any LEDs on here except for, can't even see it on there. Quick testaroo here, we're back up and running, but I'm about to go back, pull out the AC, and see how long the UPS lasts. Here we go. So we got a warning, with about 2 minutes. Auto shut down. Continue. We'll just keep continuing until we fuck out. Running completely on battery at the moment. I'm gonna run out of recording time before the battery goes flat. And I'll stop and come back when we flatten the fucking battery.
Boys and girls, Earth people around the circle, mixtures of man alive.
Yep, so just pop the back cover off here, and yes, it's gonna need a good clean and a dust as well. Beam in on me, baby. So give it the full treatment. Take this cage off so we can see what goodies are underneath. If I'm going to do this properly, I've got to take these cards out. So I've removed the card cage here that had a fan in it. It cools what's sort of the south bridge on the motherboard and also these graphics cards. And there's a custom card here that I'm really excited to look at. So I'm gonna have to take them out. But it's for the greater good. I'm going to have to cut and replace these cable ties to do this properly. But it's got to be done. In order to give this a proper clean, I'm going to have to take this board out and get to the board that's underneath it. We'll have a quick look while we're there. So, interesting to note, there's only washers on the bottom screw and not on the top. So, probably because the board is being supported off all of these screws. But anyway, let's whip it out and have a quick squeeze. So, as expected, there's not much there. These are just Ethicon panel mounts that link off to those UTP cables there too, and DVI cables. Yeah, not really a lot to talk about on this board. It's the MA Lincoln soundboard. We've got 12 volts and ground coming in here. This is a small signal relay. Must be for the CAN bus, something to do with CAN bus connector for the connection of wings. Two USB ports here coming from straight from the motherboard. This is CAN bus input. Over here, this is coming from the motherboard connectors over there. And there's a small LM386 amplifier in there that's driving this little speaker. Reset button there also, which connects over to the motherboard. Of note, a quick little hack if you wanted to get sound out of this. There's a spitif connector there, and I'm also thinking that might be a another audio header, so something worth looking at. Firewire over there, but nobody's gonna want that, so anyway. Our fire is only God, for God, for we are young and free.
All right, let's have a look at this DMX output board on the back. We've got Maxim Max 1480, complete isolated RS-485 transceivers. So they've got a built-in transformer that isolates the main power supply from the receive and transmit side of the power supply. So as well as there will be little optocouplers or something in there that's isolating the whole input side of the chip away from the rest of the system. So really a really good way to do your DMX. A lot of lights and that will just have a tiny little Texas Instruments 75176 chip in there, which doesn't have any of this stuff on board. So it's an all-in-one chip, that one, 5 volts in and your data in and out, and then you've got RS-485 bus on the other side of it. Further down in there, the SMB J6As are clamping diodes that'll clamp the voltage to about 10 volts, so you can't overvolt the things either. So really good protection there. Bunch of little MOVs maybe, and biasing resistors and stuff. So there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 of those Maxim chips, obviously, because there are 6 outs and an in on the back. Moving right along, in the middle section here, this is the DMX, no, this is the digital, what do they call it, DC remote input circuitry. So little resistors there, just going straight up to that bus connector, and that'll head back off to the PCI board. So yeah, you want to be careful what you put into there. And there's a 7805 little IC in the middle there. That's the voltage reference for that. So whatever you do, don't pull much current out of that, because you're not going to get it, and you could potentially damage it, but not too hard to fix. Here we've got MIDI, a 6N137, that's a optocoupler, so that'll be MIDI in, is it? Yep. And that's just providing us like a ground loop protection, really, for your MIDI input. And a LM339, which I think is a comparator, so that'll be driving the MIDI output. These big boys here will be audio transformers, balanced to unbalanced, presumably, which will also sort of stop ground loops as well, from the TC input and the audio trigger input. Which the audio trigger input goes up into a CL081P little op amp, and that's going into a AD8403, which is an analog device's digital potentiometer chip. So it's a digital volume control, basically, and it's driven by a serial signal from the PCI board, from the software telling it. So when you move the fader up and down in the sound input, that's what's going on there. And the TC will be going, avoiding all of that, and I believe it's going straight across the flat cable to the board, to the MA LTC1 chip there. So we'll have a bit closer look at that board in a minute. Oh, and I should mention the TC is going, I believe, straight into that transformer, out of that transformer, and straight across the IDC connected to the PCI board, where it's getting dealt to by a chip specific for that on the board. And this is the where am I going? This is the analog, the audio in going to the motherboard. So it's going through this mixer IC and going down to the motherboard, which, yeah, I don't know why they didn't use the mixer on the the mixer and the sound card or the motherboard. I'll have to think about that. But anyway, that's that board there. Enough about that. This would be the heart. This board is driving the DMX outputs, running the MIDI in and out, also looking after LTC, and also through the CAN bus looking after all of the front panel, faders, encoders, wheels, heaps of it. So let's have a quick look. These big chips here are the Oxford 16 PCI 954 chips. Each one of those is a 4-port UART, which is a serial controller, so it's driving 8 serial ports. From what I can figure, 7 of those are the DMX outputs and 1 DMX input, and the other last UART will be the MIDI UART in and out. So it's also got these chips have also got a local parallel port or a local bus and GPIO pin, so they're driving other things as well, like this LTC decoder chip, as well as the GPIOs, the DC remotes through the bus. So I think that's all they're doing. Yeah. So what's happening is there's 4 serial ports in here, and out this side of the chip going up into this hex inverter. That's a hex inverter up there, a 74HCO4. And that's going out to drive the transmit, receive, and direction control. So our UART can control which direction the data's going in. Mostly it's output for DMX, but there's also input for RDM. So that comes back in through these chips. There's one for each chip, you can see. These are 74HCT25D. Octal bus transceivers, so big mouthful there, but basically those two chips form a 16-bit bus, so 16 bits worth of data that can travel across that IDC to the GPIO, to the remote inputs and outputs, or to something else, and these ones as well. So they're going to be controlling direction, possibly, of data as well. Over here, this Wii chip is SJ1000. It's a CAN bus controller, so that chip is being controlled through, you follow the traces down here, and it actually just goes through this Octal bus transceiver into the second Oxford quad UART. Although it's not going in through the UART, on this side of the chip is the local bus, and the GPIOs on this side of the chip is serial ports. So, and these sides of the chips go down to the PCI bus itself and talk to the motherboard and the CPU. So that is the kind of CAN bus director, and next to it is a TGA 1050 CAN bus transceiver. So that's the equivalent of like a 751-76485 bus transceiver. It connects the bus to TTL level stuff for this chip to take in and talk to the bus through the interface here. What else have we got? There's two blank pads here. There's a pad here for a 93C460, which is a EEPROM, 1 kilobit EEPROM. So those, and there's also an SMD pad there, but yeah, these, you can have an EEPROM store the configuration for these chips, but I think that what's happened, that's kind of an option, because
these chips are probably being configured through the PCI bus in the software, so not needing these little EEPROMs there to tell them what to do when they start up, because they'll start up in a sort of factory state, and then once the MA2 started, it will configure it and tell it what it's supposed to be, you know, what it's supposed to be doing, what mode it's supposed to be in, because it has a couple of different modes. You can use this chip as a PCI sort of bridge as well, apparently. So yeah, it's pretty cool. Over here, don't really get why, but there's a NAND gate and also a demultiplexer, a 3-to-1 demultiplexer. So what I think might be happening is, no, actually I have no idea. It's coming in here to this, I think Trace is going to this LTC chip, but I don't really know why. Anyway, but this chip here, I recognize it's actually, you know, I don't want to pull the label off, but that's an Actel FPGA, but it's most likely got in it it's an Actel FPGA, but it's also got flash memory in it, so it stores its bitstream in there for how it's supposed to be configured to performance function, and it's probably most likely got a Eureka core from a company in the UK that makes a firmware, I guess, for this chip that lets it be a LTC decoder and also generator, I think, but the generation's not supported here. But out of this chip we have a data and a clock, and that's read by it's not read by one of the UARTs. It's probably on the GPIO or the parallel port of this Oxford quad UART chip. So interestingly, it's got a 4 megahertz crystal here. I think this might be an LTC clock, because I think this is being clocked at 16 megahertz from the PCI bus, because from what I read in the data sheet, this needs a bit more than 4 megahertz to keep traveling. But it's getting its input across the IDC connector from the other board, which is just, yeah, pretty much shoving it over this cable straight into it, I think. But I'm not sure of the purpose of this demultiplexer. It might have been, well, I haven't really investigated enough, but it might have been for sort of a future expansion. That's about it for this board. The resistors up here to, and then it just goes to the IDC connector, which goes off to the other board. So, yeah. But this is where it's all at. This is a really, this chip is a high performance UART, so it's a really good chip to use for this. You know, people go, "Oh, computers can't generate a solid DMX stream because of concurrency and all sorts of other issues, you know, and interrupts and whatever," but it's got 128 byte FIFO, receive and transmit on each UART, so a quarter of a DMX frame can be buffered inside this chip. And given how good the software is, I don't think that buffer even fills up to, like, it wouldn't even get a quarter of the way, because it's constantly being updated to send DMX out here. So super good chip to choose for the job, really, because quad UARTs, 8 UARTs, easy, fast. You've got your LTC that you can tap in on some GPIOs, and you've got your MIDI in and out, which is, you know, really slow, really, but these chips can do 15 megabits per second on each UART, but DMX is only 250 kilobits per second, so you've got something around 240%, 240 times headroom, I mean. Plenty of play to go there. Of course, while we're here, we're going to replace the battery. Let's measure the old one. Oh, nice. 2.1 volts yet. No, we just put a brand new fresh 3 volt battery in there. So sweet as.
These are boring video cards. They're just video cards. They're basically video cards. NVIDIA chipset. GV N210D3. Big heatsink, custom jobby, I might think. I don't know, actually, they might come like this, who knows. One thing I thought German efficiency would have picked up is, given the VGA connectors aren't being used, and the layout of the card frame, these, if you took them out, you'd have slightly improved air efficiency. Yeah, I'm sure they traded that off in a meeting somewhere and discussed whether it was worth doing, but I'm actually going to be borrowing one of these to fix something I broke. So I'm pretty much done cleaning in here. I've gone over the whole heatsink and fan with the brush, gone over the whole board, brushed up the dust, vacuumed it all out. Got a bit of a good collection here, so I'm going to put this all back together and turn it back on, I suppose. We'll better have a look under the front too.
It'll take more than Corona to wipe this country out. We've seen floods and fires and a massive fucking drought. And when my grandkids ask me what life was like in the 20s, God help me. Fucking COVID-19.
Just of note, this foot here, this like nylon plug insert into the board, its only purpose there is to stop this card smashing into the graphics card's heatsink. But well, I think it's going to do a pretty good job. This card is literally sandwiched in between two graphics cards. It's a quite a tight fit. I almost feel like they've got a thicker board than these graphics cards. In fact, they do. Like, looking at it, that this is slightly thicker. It's a nice firm fit. It's not going to go anywhere. It's also held down by the top of the card cage when it goes on. But yeah, nice little touch there, and one little nylon foot gets the job done. The rest of the cabling insulates this board from the next graphics card that's about to go in. I really would have loved to get my scope on this board and look at what's going on and run the logic analyzer over the DMX and just see how well it's lined up, but I can't get to it. Obviously, there is a thick metal panel here when it's running, along with a graphics card that, to be authentic, I'd have to have there, but yeah. So, but I'll try and take a look at the DMX outputs and stuff and see how clean that is. So this is how the card ha- oh shit, there goes the light. Okay. So here's the card cage back on the unit. Note these screws and then lugs to keep the cards in place. That's pretty much it, but this is solid once it's screwed down. See down there, I'm going to screw it back in. I've removed the VGA connectors to improve the airflow through this unit, whichever direction it goes in. But as you can note, there's good hackability here because there's also there's an additional slot that you could put something in and access. So it's only a a PCIe one lane thing, I think. But yeah, maybe you can get a sound card or something in there. Anyway, done. I'm gonna screw it back together. So I'm not entirely sure if it's genius, but this board has been cut off just there, and it gives just the right amount of angle to get to there before your screw falls out when you're putting it together. So could be a fluke, but it's probably German efficiency and engineering excellence. The only thing that I've seen inside here so far that's come away is this plastic clip. It's double-sided tape, and that is probably what winds up with this I found inside the case. So I actually don't think it was possibly never attached to anything. I found this in the bottom of the case, and this was attached to the flex here, so fail. But anyway, I would prefer that flapping around there, so I'm going to leave it like that. Just a quick note here, here's the servo motor that lifts the screen up and down. This pinion's rotating along this track and making the screen hold and move up and down. There's a gas strut there that you'll see in the front later that supports it while the power's off, because this motor stays on when the console's on and holds the screen in position and moves it up and down. So, and there's two limit switches in there. There's one of them. The other one down there. I can't quite get my finger on it. There we go. And those are the foremost up and down positions. Interesting to note too, for safety regulations in Germany, they've had to actually put a little warning sticker on the side, you're probably seeing, but that's about pinch points, particularly about pinch points for the front, because there's not much of a pinch point here if you lay the screen down. So anyway,
nothing, 14, nothing, 15, nothing.
Yep.
So, 12, something, 5, kilos, round. Yep, so that's it.
So, just running the scope over the CAN bus or MA link socket, and pretty much identified the CAN bus high and low. It's also 12 volts and 5 volts available from that socket as well, so I'll write up a pinout for it. I wouldn't jump start my car off it, but I imagine there's a bit of 12 volt current you could get out of that. Here I've got three channels of the scope hooked up to the RS485 buses. I've got two on the A and B, or I've got one on the A, one on the B, and then one on the F, because these four and these three are coming from different Oxford chips, but I just thought we'll see how they line up. And as kind of expected, they are all nice and lined up perfectly. So every frame coming out of there is timed perfectly to the next one. I haven't got a node or anything here, so I can't show you the console lined up with the network. But yeah, as expected, that's looking rock solid, and it's not going anywhere, so very good. Take a bit of a closer look. But there's a little bit out here. The data's not going to be the same because there's stuff patched differently here, and there'll be there's just a demo show file running, so lined up really well at the start. Yeah, anyway, very cool. Put my own test hard drive in here, so it's 180 gig, really easy. It's just a laptop hard drive with SATA and power, but there's the factory disk, which will be updated to the latest firmware and everything before it goes back to its home. And take a look at all the shit that came out of it. It was just revolting. It's not the worst I've seen, but it's never been cleaned since it was built. So there you go. And yeah, all of that jazz off the buttons and on the other side of them as well. I swear I saw something moving in there. Oh, this hair. These were from back when I had long hair. So, so for testing purposes, and while I was, you know, getting to know the system, I made a little sort of pseudo operating system for it. It can be started like that. You can see the screens are inverted so that our picture comes up the right way. What happens in MA2 is they actually draw on the screens upside down. Let's wait for it to catch up. There we go. So, unfortunately, I've not been able to get the touchscreens going. I can read data from them. I could have written a little application that took that data and turned it into X events. Unfortunately, the module that these are TouchKit eGalax displays, and this is a separate sort of different kind of touchscreen, a multi-touchscreen. Interestingly, it comes with its own software and C library and everything, a pre-compiled binary. I'm thinking that maybe they didn't have access to the source code to get the multi-touch screen into the main software, but they certainly did for these. There's a program on there called T-Panel D that runs, takes the data from the touchscreens and presents it on a device called TK panel, I think, and it can be read from there, and Green MA2 will be reading that itself rather than using X Windows inputs for the touchscreen. So I've got to plug in a USB mouse for the minute. As I said, it would have been possible because you can read the data there, it's all there, but it would have been possible to write a little application that would have taken the data and spat it out put it into X as X events. So let's have a look at So we've got TK panel 0 and TK panel 1 There, if there was external screens added on, they would come up as 2 and 3. You can actually read the data from them, but it's kind of useless. Let's go. And as I touch the screen, you can see the data, you know, and there's actually a file in there that explains the format of the data. I don't know if they left that there intentionally or not, but yeah, we could read that data and turn it into mouse events, but be bothered, not really. I did try getting Xorg modules specific to this touchscreen. They're only available pre-compiled, and they weren't available for the Xorg server that that is being used. So what are we running? Let's have a look. X dash. Yeah. Some idiot. So yeah, Xorg server 1.19.6 is quite old, and there's no pre-compiled module for this X server, so no touchscreens. But never mind, you can plug in a mouse. One of the other limitations is you can't drag windows between screens. You can open different things on different windows. Right click there and bring up the menu, and I don't know, let's open something. So, but you can't, because of the, it's set up as three independent screens, using the Xorg Cinerama function, you could, but the way that it's set, I didn't want to mess with the original X configuration. It was just sort of easier to knock it up this way. Some applications work great with that layout in a multi-screen configuration, like Flight Gear, for example, can talk to these independent screens and render its viewports on those screens. But a compositing window manager like Compiz or something could do the job of moving these across screens, but it didn't happen for me using the X server that was available. I did run another X server on here, but it was, yeah, to try and stay original to the original OS, so I just didn't. I can probably talk about that a bit further later. Pretty basic sort of stuff. It's, if you're trying to get sound out of here, you want to fire up the mixer, and you're looking for PCM, so that tiny little speaker in the back. When the Grand MA software shuts down, or by default actually, I think it's this is at zero, so if you set up the sound fader, you could turn that up and beforehand, but if you get in here and you want sound, bang, on there. Like I was saying too, you can actually, it doesn't show it. I couldn't get pulse working because I just couldn't, so I gave up. So all sounds by ALSA. Firefox. So if you plug it into the internet and get an IP address that if you can't access the internet, it will try. Muck it around. There's the multi-track audio recording software there. There's a few games in there, Flight Gear, Scorched 3D, Alien Arena, and Assault Cube. Assault Cube's my favourite, it's pretty cool. But just mucking around. But really, this was built as a foundation so I could get in and, you know, explore the system, find my way through, make changes or whatever. So, although this operating system here that I've put together is in no way going to damage the original file system and operating system that Grand MA2 runs on. That's loaded as a initial RAM disk, so that entire kernel and file system loads into memory and runs all the software from memory when you're running, except for Grand MA2, the binary, it's loaded off the disk. But the Xorg server and everything as well, it's all in RAM. So you can screw with it and change it all you like, and then reboot, and it's going to go back to how it was, with the exception of files in /etc and some files in /bar, I think, that are overlaid from the disk onto that file system. So, yeah, you can sort of screw stuff up, but you're not really going to. But everything that you do in this operating environment here is separated from all of that, so you can access the file system that's underneath it from in here, but any changes that you make are overlaid on top of that and don't change the underlying files on the file system. So there's a few things that the most interesting things are in /user/local/bin, in which auto start is a script that the console starts. That starts up Grand MA. Flip displays, I wrote to just flip the screens over so they're in the correct orientation. This just displays some little info. Tried to move some stuff to the other screen there and whatever. But yeah, interesting scripts in here. SMT, that's the multi-touch reader that I was talking about before, that's got its own C library and everything. That's it there. So on that basis, I think it was supplied to MA as a binary, and they probably never got the original source code for it. If we have a look in dev, we can see these devices here. These are devices exposed by the GMA driver kernel module, which is the custom driver that's been written for that custom PCI card we were looking at before. Got DMX outputs, the GPIOs, that's going to be the DC remote in, maybe some other stuff too, but not totally sure. GMA input, I don't know exactly what that one's doing. The MIDI driver, the mixer, it will be that digital potentiometer chip that's driving the level control for the audio in, and that's for the timecode chip that's off one of those Oxford ICs as well. So yeah, unfortunately none of the source for that's available, so I did poke at it a little bit, but it didn't really need to. I mean, you could hijack this MIDI device, and I put together another compilation environment, so I was actually able to get the kernel config from where is it, in proc, if you read config.gz, that's actually the kernel compilation configuration, so I was able to compile my own kernel and all the modules that go with it, because only the very bare essentials have been included in here. So if you wanted to add a device to the system somehow, there's a very good chance that there's no kernel support for it, but using that config file and getting the right kernel version and the right C build environment, you can build your own kernel modules. So yeah, that's doable. Although that's not X modules for the touchscreens like I was talking about. So let's have a look in lib. So in here there is the 800x480 firmware. I believe that's only 128 bytes. So those ICs that I was showing before that have the two white dots and the one white dots are probably just, they produce that in the factory, but for some reason they've included this here. it's not like MA7 inch, don't know. There's the drivers in there for the firmware, actually, there for the Ethernet controllers as well. Modules. So there's the GMA driver. That driver and it's actually not stripped, so you can look at the debug symbols in there, and it. Well, I'm not going to say it's not complicated, but it wouldn't be impossible using the data that's available for those Oxford chips and the other chips that we looked at earlier, like the mixer chip and the LTC chip, to kind of use this to guide you in the right direction as to how those are being handled. Pretty much what this driver will be doing is acting as an interface between the file, like between the kernel and you can see here that it's calling things such as GMA2 register CAN device. So the CAN device on the board is a SJA1000, and there is a kernel module for the SJA1000 already. Net CAN. It's built in. I built it as well, but it's already built in. So that is just basically going to be linking. There it is. That module there will be linking. That'll be the module that's used to drive that chip. But the Grand MA driver, this guy here, is going to just be the middleman for that. So this is the TouchKit USB kernel module. So that works fine. There's no point in rebuilding that. It was the Xorg module that we were trying to get a hold of, but didn't spend too long there. A couple little tricks that it does, because those Oxford chips would be detected by the kernel's built-in drivers for those chips. That driver is blacklisted somewhere in here, so that it is not loaded in preference of the other driver as well. So that this driver can get in over the top of it. So that's a little bit of a look there. What else does this do? Not a great deal, really, but it is Ubuntu based, so if you wanted to go and add something to it, you can do a apt-cache search for apt search, and let's find something, and it'll list all the installable packages that, if you were connected to the internet, you could do an apt-get install and install those packages. So your mileage is going to vary on what's going to work and what's not, but there's a good chance that a chunk of it will work. This environment is built on the latest Ubuntu bootstrap. It's been bootstrapped from the latest Ubuntu. It doesn't have everything.
Sorry, hang on.
It doesn't have absolutely everything in it. Like, why would I want a word processor? So I didn't put any of that gear in there. But I think what I might do is zip all that up. And all I have in it zips down to about 3.5 gigs, so that'll fit on a USB stick and be able to be sort of a portable thing. I don't know, it's just really, I used it while I was working out the CAN bus, so I think I got Yeah, see, it's coming up here. It's going, you're either root account, you might harm your system. Well, that's, yeah, it's not going to harm your system. It's just going to harm this system. It's not going to harm the underlying console. So, yeah, don't worry too much about that. Main reason why I made this was so that I could... so that I could do some CAN bus investigationing. Of course it's just fucking crashed on me, so I'll kill that. Yeah. So when you leave here anyway, it will. So we'll go here, log out, goodbye. And it's going to kill everything it's just started. And it's going to go bang, straight back to grandma. It does actually kill grandma. So that's a reboot. So you can't use it as a lighting desk while you're mucking around in there. But you optionally... this X term, if you hit there, it'll open up a terminal down here. You can do a lot of the same stuff, but just note that when you click on, if you touch the screen, grandma still thinks you're trying to touch her, so don't touch your grandma. Yeah, so that's a bit of a look at that. I don't know, it's just a toy, really.